Cod Commission hearing, the Cape Cod Commission continued the project to the hearing officer. That was from the February 14th meeting. In the interim, the applicant has submitted supplementary material, which is in the record. Commission has copies of those materials, which is responsive to some of the questions and concerns raised at the last public hearing. Chief among which is a condition which the applicant has agreed to abide by, which augments and references specifically the visual mitigation plan, which was provided in their direct testimony at the last hearing as well. So from here, I am moving to continue the public hearing to the Cape Cod Commission meeting for February 28th at 3:05 p.m. in this room. So in late terms, that means you can sit here, and the Cape Cod Commission is going to have a public hearing on this project in approximately 5 minutes.
At this time, we will open the regular meeting of the Cape Cod Commission, noting that it's Thursday, February 28th, 2013, at approximately 3 p.m. in the First District Courthouse Assembly of Delegates Chamber. First order of business is roll call.
Barnstable, Royden Richardson.
Present.
Bourne, Michael Blanton.
Present.
Brewster, Elizabeth Taylor. Chatham is vacant. Dennis, Richard Roy, present. Eastham, Joy Brookshire.
Here.
Falmouth, Andrew Putnam.
Here.
Falmouth is vacant. Mashpee, Ernest Virgilio. Orleans, Leonard Short.
Here.
Provincetown, Austin Knight.
Present.
Sandwich, Joanne O'Keefe. Truro, Peter Graham.
Here.
Wellfleet, Roger Putnam.
Here.
Yarmouth, John McCormick Jr.
Here.
County Commissioner Mary Pat Flynn. Minority Representative John Harris. Native American Representative is vacant. Governor's appointee Herb Olson. Mr. Chairman, we have a quorum.
Thank you. Next item on our agenda is the Executive Director's Report.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just briefly, we last week had an opportunity to present on the wastewater issue, our watershed MVP program, a presentation from the Boston Society of Civil Engineers up at the Harvard Graduate School of Design. And then earlier this week, we were asked to present at a federal users conference in Washington, D.C. on that same program that we talked about. There is more developing on the 208 plan. We've made some outreach to the towns. We've talked to the town managers. We're going to get in front of the Cape Cod Selectmen and Councilors Association next week. And then we'll hopefully have a more formal communication to the towns by the end of next week. And with that, I just want to keep my report short so we can get on with the meeting since we're tight on quorum. Thank you.
Thank you. Next item on the agenda is a public hearing on the Sagamore Line Reinforcement Project. This is a continued hearing from the hearing that just ended with the hearing officer. There is a sign-in sheet at the back of the room for anyone who wishes to speak on the project, and members of the public who have been expressed wishes to speak on the project, we would appreciate it if they would please sign in and note that they would like to speak.
Point of order, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah.
Point of order. I believe we might have skipped the public comment section.
You're right. I'm sorry. Thank you very much. I ask if there's any public comment
on any item that's not on the agenda.
I'm sorry?
Public comment is for any item not on the agenda. It's not on this proceeding.
Okay. I'm sorry. I skipped the order of business. I should have asked if there is anyone in the public who would like to speak on any item that is not on the agenda. Seeing none, we'll get back to the hearing on the Sagamore Line Reinforcement Project. All who are going to speak or give testimony, please stand to be sworn in. Please repeat after me. I, John McCormick. Swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Thank you. At this time, I'll ask the applicant to make their presentation on the project.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good afternoon, Chair McCormick, commission members, commission staff, and members of the public. Thank you for the opportunity to speak today. For the record, my name is Mike Kaler, and I'm appearing today on behalf of the Colonial Gas Company, who's the applicant in this proceeding. Today, I want to focus briefly on the supplemental information that we have provided to the commission, and to again respectfully request that the commission vote to adopt the draft decision and approve the company's project. As you know, at the meeting on February 14th, the commission voted to remand this proceeding back to the hearing officer in order to allow for the development of further information on issues discussed on the 14th. With my remarks at this moment, I want to focus on two issues in particular: the company's visual mitigation program and the noise impacts associated with the removal of the 10 to 15 foot strip of existing vegetation required to construct the project. With respect to the company's visual mitigation program, we have provided a full explanation of the plan through our written testimony as initially filed on January 15th, and in the company's oral testimony from the public hearings on January 23rd and February 14th. Our February 20th supplemental filing provides additional detail in response to certain points raised by the commission and members of the public at the last hearing. As we've stated throughout, we will work in good faith with each affected homeowner within 300 feet of the project layout to implement post-construction vegetative screening. We recognize that there's some judgment involved in this process, but it's our objective to satisfy the legitimate concerns of each affected homeowner. To formalize the company's commitment in this regard, the company has proposed that the final decision approving the project include a detailed condition. That condition is in your materials, and in essence, what it proposes is that prior to the issuance of a final certificate of compliance, the company will provide a full report to commission staff. This report will detail how the visual mitigation program was implemented, including a specific discussion of any situation where the company and an affected homeowner were not able to agree on a mutually satisfactory planting plan. If there are any such instances of continued disagreement at the time of the filing, commission staff will have the ability to review the specifics and to work with the homeowner and the company to resolve the matter. Inclusion of this condition in the final decision should provide additional assurance to the commission and to the public with respect to the implementation of the visual mitigation program and for continuing commission oversight in the event that any disagreements arise. We hope that the proposed condition also provides ample assurance to affected homeowners that the company will stand by its commitment to reasonably mitigate visual impacts. Second, the company has provided additional expert witness testimony to further support the conclusion that construction of the project will have no incremental adverse noise impacts. The incremental change in sound levels from Route 6, if any, associated with the proposed scope of vegetation clearing necessary to construct the project would simply not be discernible to the human ear. Illustrative calculations using very conservative assumptions indicate that the removal of 10 to 15 feet of vegetation could result in a foliate season, meaning when the leaves are on the trees, increase of approximately 0.2 dBA. This very slight difference in sound levels would be imperceptible to homeowners, and in fact would be virtually impossible to detect by measurement. With that, I'll close. Members of the project team are available and able to answer any questions that people may have. We believe that the additional information provided fully addresses the concerns expressed at the hearing 2 weeks ago. Based upon the full record of this proceeding, the company has shown that the project is consistent with the commission's standards and that the benefits of the project outweigh any potential detriments. We therefore respectfully request that the commission approve the project. Thank you.
Thank you. I would now ask any Sandwich officials who would like to comment, please come to the podium.
Hi, for the record, my name is Paul Tilden, DPW Director and Town Engineer, and thank you for the opportunity to speak today. I just want to give you a little bit of history as far as the town's role with this project is concerned. We met with National Grid about 2 years ago, probably more extensively over the last year or so, to talk about the project. We met at their request to take a look at the initial proposal and to provide comment on that. And along with the Water Department, we had determined that the initial proposal for the gas line was not at the best location along the service road. There's a number of reasons for that. I'm sure you've heard many of these already. I'll just briefly go over some of those. First of all, there's an existing water main out there, and the Water District is very concerned about potential disruption of future repairs and installation of the water main or service lines out there. We also wanted to make sure that the road corridor was reserved for town utilities, which is what it should be reserved for, such as sewer, potential sewer in the future, or drainage improvements. Now, the service road is about a 100-foot layout, which is larger than most layouts you'll see throughout Cape Cod. And the road layouts are just for that reason. They're preserved for utilities, such as a gas line or other utilities as well. So we thought that the gas line would be more appropriate within that 100-foot layout. A couple other issues. The gas company already has two gas lines already along the service road, so we didn't think a third was appropriate there. And should be reserved for other utilities. The 20-inch gas main is also very difficult to work around and probably impossible to relocate. So if you do pick a location for the gas main, we want to make sure it stays there and we don't have to relocate that. The 20-inch gas main probably requires a lot of extension maintenance, inspection, and testing. And if that was near the road, that would cause a lot of disruption to the service road. Again, another reason why we wanted to locate that gas main within the wide layout that we have along the service road. Throughout our review process, we're fully aware of the initiative at the local level, the regional level, and the state level to provide a Cape-wide connection of bicycle paths. We know Yarmouth and Barnstable are planning that right now and trying to get funds for that. In the future, that will come to Sandwich to provide that entire connection as well. And knowing that the Claire Salt Install bike route runs along the service road, we thought that would be an ideal location for a potential bike path in the future. So we also want to make sure that the National Grid gas line didn't interfere with any of our potential plans for a bicycle path out there as well. And so they went back to design, tried their best to accommodate their needs as well as ours, and also trying to minimize the amount of tree cutting out there as much as possible. And another thing I'd like to mention, we understand that there will be vegetative impacts out there. We understand the residents' concern. And we agree that it's very important to make sure that National Grid is committed to mitigating those impacts to provide to the vegetative buffer and restore that buffer as much as possible. As part of any bike plan that we might have in the future, we would certainly try to supplement that with funding for trees as well to plant along that corridor. And we do have access to tree grants as well, which we would further install out there along the service road to help mitigate that vegetative buffer. So at this point, I'm open to any questions, if you have any.
Any questions from the commission? Thank you.
All right, thank you for your time.
Anyone else from the town of Sandwich care to speak? At this time, are there any other government officials, federal, state, or local, that would care to speak? If not, at this time, I would ask the members of the public who wish to speak. I would caution them that we try to limit your time to no more than 2 minutes, and please be aware of the fact that if somebody else has already mentioned something one or two or three times, I don't think it's necessary to repeat it again. Thank you. The first name I have on the list of people who want to speak is Mr. Robert Doherty.
I'm Bob Doherty. I live at 2 Noel Henry Drive off of Service Road. My wife and I lived there for the last year. I didn't get to the first two meetings. I had cancer surgery at Cape Cod, and it was in recovery mode. I do oppose this natural gas line here. I understand it's going to be from 270 to 575 pounds per square inch pressure. This is truly high pressure gas. In the last, from 2010 to 2013, there are 102 oil and natural gas line accidents, and since 2000, there have been 228. In September 2010, the main distribution high pressure gas line in San Bruno, California had a catastrophic failure. Explosion of fire resulted in 36 homes and 8 people incinerated. The gas explosion blew a hole in the ground 126 feet by 26 and 20 feet deep, and the gas plume extended 300 to 400 feet from where the fracture was. This is all on YouTube. I have a handout here for anybody that wants it. The way you can see this, it is quite unusual. There are 50 homes on the service road or just adjacent to it that are within 300 or 400 feet that will easily be incinerated. There were other instances here where, you know, you talk about the safety of these pipelines, right? And they're all tested, they're all x-rayed and everything. But after they go in the ground, they may be there 50 years before, unless something happens, a casualty of some kind. Now, this one happened in 2012, December 11th. The Ensource, a parent of Columbia Gas, pipeline exploded in Sissonville in West Virginia. Several people had minor injuries. 4 homes were destroyed and buildings damaged. Reports by the NTSB was investigating why the alarms in the control room never warned them.
Excuse me, Mr. Doherty, would you be able to wrap it up?
Yeah, all right. The 50 homes on the service road are within 125 to 200 feet. 4 of them are dead end. If there's a casualty on that pipeline, that road's going to be blocked off. The fire department will not be able to get there. And the people will be trapped. They'll have to escape somewhere through the conservation land. But I want to impress upon people that they should watch this video. And here's 25 copies if you want to pass these around.
Mr. Doherty, if you wish, we'll get that to the clerk and we'll make it part of the record.
Yeah. I have another copy.
Thank you. Nancy Mann.
I'm Nancy Mann, 15 Overlook Drive. I did not get to speak last time, which we were all given 5 minutes, but there was a motion to continue the meeting. Cape Cod is a jewel. And for those of us who love this place, we think that everyone else feels the same way. But others see it as a place to exploit and plunder for their own benefit. And that is why we have the Cape Cod Commission, created to protect the fragile nature of Cape Cod, its beauty, its wildlife, and also its people. Today we see that we need the protection of the Commission more than ever. I'm not Jane Fonda. This is not the sort of thing that I do. So it means a lot that this is really serious that I'm standing up here today. I've been up all night writing this. I've had no sleep. Enter Keyspan, presenting itself as a benevolent do-gooder for the people. But as Mr. Wences said in the August 10th, 2006 Commission Decision Summary, page 10, the forecasted growth led Keyspan to develop this proposal. Translated, Keyspan sees Cape Cod as a place to make lots of money in the future. It's only about money for them. With all the cumbersome and rules and regulations, Keyspan has to pretend to want to be a good neighbor. But as exhibited in all 21 pages of that report, getting their way is more important than the safety of their customers around the other deleterious end results from this project. And the siding board in Boston is evidently willing to help them and negate the authority of the commission and disregard the needs of the people of Cape Cod. Why are we letting Boston govern us? As far as the public hearing notice, we repeatedly said that no one got them. There are people here that never got them. We are still finding abutters who were never notified. And for those who did, it was vague. It was left out that the north side was going to be the area where the pipeline was going. Instead, it blatantly states along Service Road, letting everyone to believe that it was going along the south side where the gas lines already were. And everyone said, what's the big deal? They're just going to work on their line, which is why nobody came to anything. The hearings, Mr. Wences, at the February 14th meeting, had the hubris to say we didn't need another hearing because everyone that was concerned was already here. Take a look. Do you see those people were here the last time? No. But he did not want another hearing because they want you to rubber stamp this thing through as fast as you can. A public hearing for the public held during the day when the public can't get here, everyone's working, is another problem. And plus, a lot of people are away in Florida, as we know. The highway noise scientific report, that was just discussed. Since the higher noise level is now evident with winter, the report's conclusion. This is from the initial brief of Colonial Gas, January 30th, page 14, footnote 8. The incremental noise impact from Route 6 associated with the proposed scope of vegetation clearing will be negligible and simply not discernible to the human ear. It is erroneous. Scientific studies are not always so accurate as to effects on people, as exhibited by the current Falmouth wind turbine fiasco.
Mrs. Mann, there are a lot of people, I think, that want to speak. And
well, I know, but this is really important, and I would please ask for this, okay? Because there's information here that you don't have, and I think other people want to hear this, too. Okay, I don't have that much more. I talk fast. I'm from New York, so I can talk really, 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 really fast. Okay? Under state regulations, noise is considered to be an air contaminant. How is it that the commission staff found sound impacts likely to be limited in scope and duration? Why? Because they don't live there? This does not appear to mesh with the commission's stated goal to protect the communities of Barnstable County, and therefore must weigh both the environmental and human impacts of the project in this context. Character Service Road. Commission staff finds the service road is not designated scenic. In Barnstable, it is scenic, yet there is little or no difference. The staff's opinion the proposed clearing will result in a more open character to the roadway, but is not expected to have a significant impact on screening of Route 6 from Service Road and such. Is consistent with protection of existing character and avoid adverse visual impact is insulting to Service Road area residents. How can this project possibly comply with those standards? Then there is the robust visual mitigation plan to be carried out. With a cavalier attitude and arbitrary decision-making, persons of the gas company to screen our houses. Screen from what? What are we supposed to do? Hide in the shrubbery from the service road? Please?
Yeah, could you wrap it up, please?
Sure. Both sides of the service road make up our neighborhood, and it's the cul-de-sac for our streets. This is a residential street, not an industrial slush way. And now the promise of the grass, the tip farm, okay, as was brought up the last time, the grass that they're going to seed in may be cut once or twice a year. That is the habitat for ticks. Ticks live in grass 18 to 24 inches. So now we have a health situation where a breeding ground 4.4 miles strip of Lyme disease. And on the initial brief, okay.
Please.
I'm sorry, you can throw me out.
We have 20 people here.
I know, but they're here because of us. They're not here because...
You're speaking for all of them, is that what you're saying?
I'm saying that the reason that they're here and they want to hear this information because they don't have it. Okay, they're very brief.
The information is all in the public record, but...
They didn't know it.
I'll give you 5 more seconds.
Fine. The cost of the revised plan is now slightly less expensive. How slightly? $10? This is to meet the mandate for the siding board, which says that it has to have minimum impact and be less expensive. How do you say less expensive than clearing 5 to 6 acres of trees and regrading 4.4 miles? And finally, to say that the town of Sandwich, unlike Dennis and Yarmouth, who went to fight for their residents, has considered the residents of Service Road area not worth much and therefore a worthwhile sacrifice for this project for the bike path, which the citizens of Sandwich voted against and did not want the bike path on the Service Road. So this is the way to circumvent the votes of the people in the town. As someone said from the town on January 23rd, unfortunately, it doesn't work out for everybody.
Please.
Thank you.
Now I have a Kurt Mann. Mr. Mann, I assume that was your wife that testified?
Yes.
You have something to say that she didn't say?
Yes, I do.
Fine, thank you.
Yes, I live at 15 Overlook Drive, too. Why does the gas company / National Grid even draft alternative route plans for their pipeline when they have absolutely no intention of ever considering them? Is this to make us feel good, like they really care? Yeah, right. It's bad enough they have to ruin the natural ambience nature provides by cutting all the trees and plants on the north side of the Service Road in Sandwich for 15 feet. They will never come back. The gas company, is also putting the people's lives in the drive on the Service Road in harm's way with the possibility of a breach of the line and explosion. Homes and cars will be incinerated. People, children, and pets may die. The people of the gas company will have to live with themselves. On page 7 of the commission's report, it talks about all that. And I got it right here if you want. The commission finds that the MEPA process is created to identify the environmental impacts of the proposed project, but does not include an analysis of the human or social impacts. The commission's goal is in part to protect the communities of Barnstable County and therefore must weigh both the environmental and human impacts of the project in this context. Does the Cape Cod Commission really have any teeth, or are we going to let the people in Boston at the DPU and the siding board call all the shots? Where is the spirit of cooperation and goodwill? I don't see any. Why do we in the Cape Cod Commission always acquiesce to greedy big utility companies?
Mr. Mann, I think you are repeating what was said before. I'd ask
quite.
You to wrap it up, please.
I will. As documented in the Cape Cod Commission's August 10, 2006 report, the disingenuous treatment of the towns of Harwich, Dennis, and Yarmouth, the gas company disregarded any and all alternate plans before even considering them. Are the DPU, siding board, and gas company all in bed together? And that's all right in your report, and more. They just don't want to cooperate with anybody. The railroad beds that's already there, they already have a right-of-way. They don't have to cut many trees. They put a gas pipeline there. And also, they do go down the power lines. It's right here on this pipeline here. The 3.5-mile pipeline, which was installed along the existing NSTAR right-of-way in 2007, supplies natural gas for distribution by National Grid. And they said that they couldn't go down the right-of-way of the power lines. Well, they've already done it right here for 3.5 miles.
Mr. Mann.
Why can't they do it all the
way through? You are repeating what has already been said. I tried to limit...
Oh, just keep cutting more trees down.
I want everyone to speak, but they're not going to get a chance if everybody keeps repeating the same thing. Thank you.
More involved than that.
Richard Lyman.
Good afternoon, I'm Rick Lyman, I live at 1 Noel Henry. I just have a few items I want to bring up. Mr. Doherty has already mentioned that there was 242 accidents with natural gas pipelines. I have here, which I'll leave with the clerk, a brief listing of all those, but to make some points, from 2000 to 2009, 17 homes were destroyed, 9 were damaged, 35 people killed, and 56 injured. From 2010 to 2012, 76 homes were destroyed, 130 damaged, 24 people killed, and over 80 injured. That's not to count thousands of people who had to be evacuated from their homes when accidents occurred. These are from high-pressure lines. This is what's going in. In 2000, there was a high-pressure line that exploded and killed a family of 12 over 600 feet away from where the accident occurred. You want to put these pipelines well within that distance of this pipeline within those homes. That, by all means, is just a disrespect and disregard for the safety of the people of Sandwich. I will leave this with the clerk, and if anyone wants this full report of all the accidents that happened since 2010, and this doesn't include the recent one that just happened in Kansas City. This goes up to 2012, so there's already been accidents in 2013 that no one wants to address in this hearing. The safety of the people in Sandwich should be the utmost concern rather than the money going into the oil company and gas company's pockets. Thank you.
Thank you. Rosemary Fraiello.
My comment will be very short. I would like to say that I did not receive notifications of previous meetings on this subject, and I do read my mail. I didn't throw it out unread. If I had received it, I would have known about the previous meetings. What concerns me is the high-pressure lines. I live right on Service Road, very close to the road, and I would be one of the homes that would disintegrate. That concerns me, and it should concern other people who are in the same position. I had one more comment. Didn't I forget it? Oh, yes, on Thanksgiving, this past Thanksgiving Day, there was a gas leak on Service Road, and the road was shut down. I was trying to leave the house. There was no way I could leave the house. Now, in the case of a fire or a real breach in the gas line, there would be a big problem, and there's no way out. So those things like that should be considered. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Susan Oakes.
Sue's Notes, 181 Service Road. I have the same concerns as my neighbor, and I also did not receive any mailings. I would have read them if they had come to my mailbox. I did not know about the other commission meetings. That's all I have to say.
Thank you. Lauren Nordahl.
My name is Lauren Nordahl. I live at 10 Robin Road. My concern is similar, a safety concern if there is a problem and Service Road is closed or there's a fire explosion. I have this one way in and out of my neighborhood, and I have a daughter who can't walk. She's in a wheelchair. I'm sure there are other people who could not leave the neighborhood through the woods or through a back way, and it's very disturbing to think that we could be stuck there without a way to get my daughter out. So, thank you.
Thank you. Kathy Shaughnessy.
Hi,
I live at 179 Service Road next to Sue and Rue. We all have the same issues. We did not receive any of the notices that were sent out before. If we had, we would have come to the meetings. And also, I did experience the Thanksgiving Day. We did have a small gas leak somewhere down the end of the road. The road was blocked off right at my driveway. If it was a small leak, but with a big gas line that you want to put in, I can't imagine what it would have been like. So we have great concerns about this.
Thank you. Martha Flynn.
My name is Martha Flynn. I live at 13 Telegraph Hill Road, off the service road, and my concerns are the same as what have been already spoken. And I did not receive notification either about any of these meetings.
Thank you. Sally McMahon.
Hi, my name is Sally McMahon. I've been a resident of Sandwich since 1986. I live at 7 Cardinal Road. I am five houses in from the service road. I have major concerns about this service, where it's going on the service road. I don't understand why it doesn't go down next to Route 6, away from the homes. But you're talking, none of my neighbors got, I did not get notification. That was a couple of my neighbors have been standing up here. They did not get notification because we're not within the 300-foot. Excuse me, I'm nervous. I don't generally come to these types of meetings.
That's all right. Take your time.
You know, I know that it's, you know, there's the money thing, there's this thing. It's high pressure, but I'm concerned about the knolls and the berms. I'm concerned that... Okay, the gentleman talked from the DPW. We don't have sewerage up in my neighborhood. It's the first neighborhood from Route 130. We don't have water. We don't even have, we don't have water up there, only along the service road, not into the homes. So if there was any kind of a leak or an explosion, there's a problem. I said to my 14-year-old daughter, as far as the noise, and that gentleman from the gas company saying that there's so much, there's very minuscule amount of noise, you sit outside in my backyard on a nice summer night. And I said this to my 14-year-old daughter, why are you going there? I said, sit outside, open our windows on a summer night. We can hear Route 6 already. I'm five houses back. Every property in our neighborhood is at least an acre. There's major concerns, and I'm concerned that I am not notified. This is the first time I've looked at the information. And I was told that supposedly the town of Sandwich is going to be given money. Is that correct? Can anyone answer that?
I'm sorry, would you?
Really? They're right, to the tune of $185,000. I thought it was approximately $200,000. $200,000. Where is that money going to go? Into the public fund? So, okay, they can take that money, not to assure that the neighbors along the service road, that it goes to us. No, it's going to go into the public fund. It's not going to come to us. And I think there's some major concerns about the knolls and the berms and the noise. Thank you.
Thank you. Nancy Crossman.
Hi, Nancy Crossman, 15 Telegraph Hill Road. I find it very disturbing the amount of people that, especially living within the 300-foot of service road locations, that did not receive notification on this. And I don't see any difference in what was proposed by NGRID than what they proposed before. Basically, they're saying they're only going to talk to the people who are on service road or within 300 feet, And if they can't come to any kind of agreement, then you will be responsible for resolving it. And our questions at the last hearing were, what about the rest of us who use the service road as an egress from our homes? We go along it every single day, every time we go in and out, and we are affected as much, not quite as much, but as close to as much as the people who live right along service road. And we're on dead-end streets. We'll be stuck there if there's ever an accident. We're trapped. And I'm disturbed also that there was no communication given in the prior 2 weeks. We were hoping that there would be something from NGRID saying that they were going to have some sort of a plan that come up with, the town of Sandwich has a bylaw, I believe. You take a tree down, you put a tree back. So there, I would think that there should be some sort of a plan that behind this gas line, that the vegetation would be restored between where the 10 to 15 foot cut has been made and, say, the fence to the Route 6 area. That would take care of the noise and visual issues. So we did not get that. And also, should there be an accident, don't forget, Route 6 is going to be affected, too. If there's an explosion, it's going to go out into Route 6. Thank you.
Thank you. Daryl Crossman?
Good afternoon, Daryl Crossman. I'll try to have to go over my notes because I think my wife took most of my what I was going to say. So
my wife does, too.
But yeah, I think one of the biggest concerns is, like, when we were here the last meeting, and, you know, we thought that there was going to at least be some sort of contact, or, you know, with those of us at least that were here and that we had concerns, and we heard nothing. And it's obvious that there were, you know, wasn't any even notification given to abutters and even the other hearings. I think that's a very legitimate and serious concern. And again, like most of these developments, almost every single one comes off a service road. That's our only access. So if there's any kind of issue or problem, you know, we have no way of getting out. And I don't think that, and I, to say to the only affected homeowners are within 300 feet, I think is not being fair to the rest of us that obviously have concerns, you know, where we live. The concerns are sound, but they're also visual. I brought that up last time. If you drive up and down service road, you talk about taking out 10 to 15 feet of trees from the fence on out. You probably only have, if you're lucky, maybe another 10 to 15 feet of trees from there to the roadway. So you're talking about taking out probably over half the trees and other vegetation that's along that stretch. So that takes out a very big visual. And right now, especially over the last couple of storms, we've had a number of trees that have come down and, you know, fallen down. So it's getting to be like less and less. Taking any more out is going to be a big impact also for our traffic concerns in the summer at other times when there's backups on the bridges and everything. The other thing I guess I'd also have to say is what I heard one of our the Sandwich Town officials say was that afterwards it was like possibly the town of Sandwich would have to pay for or put in trees and everything that there. And I don't believe that that should be our department. If they put in a pipeline and if this gets approved and everything, that should be theirs. I mean, they put it in, they should be owning that there. And I also found it very interesting that the town official brought up the Claire Saltonstall bike path. And when I brought up concerns about it when they were redoing Exit 2, and that wasn't addressed, and yet now all of a sudden it's a concern for the town. So I would seriously, you know, question where all of a sudden this is coming from. And on the money that the town would be getting, if does that change over time? Is it always the same amount or whatever? Or is it always going to be that for the life of the pipeline? And just one other thing is, in this phase, after they put if they ever get to put this pipeline in, and what does it connect to? Where does it go to? I mean, because they don't have any phases beyond that. I believe it's only going to a certain portion in Sandwich. So is it just going to sit dormant, or, you know, what's going on with it? And do they have to wait for other approvals before they can, you know, continue this moving forward? Thank you.
Thank you. Linnell Grundman, am I pronouncing that right?
I think I checked no.
Oh, I'm sorry, you did. Jim Hurley, is it? I can't quite make it out.
Jim Hamlin?
I'm sorry.
I'll speak with Mr. Hurley.
And I'll try and be brief.
Thank you.
My concerns have been mentioned also, but my first concern is about the noise. And Council, I believe you said earlier there's no concern, and from what I understand, the gas company's stance is there'll be no noise mitigation. Am I correct on that?
Well,
Can you ask Council if that, so I understand my concerns?
I think that the applicant will have a chance to address all the questions that have been made, and we'll make sure he answers that.
Okay. If that is what I understood, that noise is not of any concern and there'll be no mitigation on that, that to me seems absurd. As stated, if you take down 10 to 15 feet of tree, they can do all the studies they want. I challenge anybody on this board to sit in my backyard after 10 or 15 feet of tree line is taken down and tell me that they don't hear a difference. It's crazy to make that assumptions. Reading some of the data, it was based on additional 50 feet of tree line on Route 6, another 50 feet on the service road on the south side. Not every home is protected by 50 feet on either on Route 6 and another 50 on the service road on the south side. They took a general sampling. They're using the math to come up with this by basing it on approximately 100 feet of vegetation, which does not exist. If you're at the end of a road that connects with it, it's wide open. There is no trees on the south side, so I don't know how they can calculate it as a whole by saying there'll be no noise impact when every single home is different. They say, in their literature, that hills and distance are the big concern. There are dips along the service road where the trees go down, and it's the tops of the trees that are protecting you. Nothing that you can plant is going to mitigate that. And finally, we're talking about taking 15 feet of trees out. If you go that 4.5 mile stretch, that is just about to the fence line. So basically, we are going to have 4.5 miles of fence line. Right now, we have shrubs on either side. To say that this isn't going to change the character of that roadway is ridiculous. 4.5 miles worth of chain link fence. I defy anyone, again, to show me a section of the Cape that has that, that is not an industrial area. That's similar to the airport or anything like that. Not a residential area. I did hear their concerns and their mitigation plan about an arbiter. I think they've come a long way on that part of it. I commend them, but I still think for safety, the aesthetics of the area and changing the character of the area and the noise and site mitigation, they still have a long way to go. Thank you.
Thank you.
And any time left, I'll give to Mrs. Mann.
I have one other name. I evidently came in after we swore everyone in. Is Jillian Baster here?
Right here.
Would you like to speak?
Yes.
All right, I'll have to swear you in. I, please state your name.
Jillian Basler.
Swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Jillian Basler. I live at 215 Mill Road, Service Road. I also have some concerns on safety, noise. I think if we take down the trees, we definitely are going to hear the noise. It's going to not only a safety risk, but it's going to depreciate the value of our homes. I, too, was trapped on Thanksgiving Day. The leak that took place was right at the mouth of our road, and we were trapped there for 4 hours. We had fire trucks, police, the gas company, and we couldn't get in and we couldn't get out. So definitely have some concerns with that. Thank you.
Thank you. At At this time, I'll ask the applicant to respond to some of the questions and comments.
Mr. Chair, I would actually respectfully request that the company could have perhaps 5 minutes just so we can discuss amongst each other.
We'll have a 5 minute recess.
Thank you.
Being the meeting at approximately 4 o'clock after 5 minute recess. Again, we'll have the applicant make his comments.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. We appreciate the opportunity to discuss a little bit, and we truly do appreciate hearing from the public, and are glad to hear the concerns raised. We want to address a couple of them, and I want to lead with the issue of safety, which is paramount to the company, as well as something that we heard a lot from the public today. So I want to introduce Mr. Ed Wences, the project manager.
Obviously, based on your feedback, safety is a major concern, among other items that you had mentioned as well. We take safety very seriously. We're a utility company. We've been in the business for a long time. That's our major charge, to maintain and operate a safe distribution system for the benefit of all of our customers. What we do is, as a regulated entity, we are, at the very least, required to follow federal as well as state requirements with regard to the design, installation, and operation of our facilities. In addition, National Grid has taken a proactive approach where our internal procedures are more stringent than both the federal and state requirements. I'll get into a little more detail about those policies and procedures that we follow with regard to designing and installing and maintaining our facilities. But also, as Paul Tilton had mentioned earlier, in terms of the collaboration that National Grid and the town had in coming up with the proposed route alignment, if you'll notice, that is off the paved roadway on the north side of Service Road, approximately 15 feet to the north side of the edge of pavement. The existing water main is in that north shoulder. It was mentioned earlier a number of incidences that had occurred on various pipelines and so on. Oftentimes, the cause is through third-party excavations. Based on the proposed alignment of this main, it's going to be several feet beyond any of the existing infrastructure. So the likelihood of a third-party excavation is highly unlikely. As far as the standard for the installation in terms of the design of the facility, we will have, as part of the procurement of the material, there'll be an inspector at the manufacturing site, at the mill, witnessing the manufacture of every stick of pipe. The material test records of every stick of pipe will be received from the manufacturer. When the pipe is delivered to the site, it'll be inspected and confirmed that that pipe that we received is what was manufactured and it meets our specification. Every joint of that pipe as it's put together will be welded. Every valve and other fitting as part of the pipeline will be welded. Every one of those joints, as was mentioned earlier, will be non-destructively tested via radiographic method or X-ray. There'll be an X-ray technician that will view each of those. They'll take a circumferential X-ray from the inner wall to the outer wall, seeing the complete weld, and checking the weld integrity. In addition, there'll be a dedicated certified welding inspector overseeing all of the welding activity. Every welder that's doing the work on the project will be certified. Every one of those welders, before they can do the work, will have to take a test and get certified. They will weld up samples of pipe similar to what they'll be welding in the field, and that will be destructively tested to confirm that they are welding per the standards. The pipe will be installed at a minimum with 3 feet of cover, so from the top of pipe to finished grade, there'll be a minimum of 3 feet of cover. 1 foot below the finished grade will be a plastic yellow warning tape, so that if anyone were by chance to excavate in the vicinity of the pipeline, they would be noticed by that warning tape. In addition, the pipe will be hydrostatically tested, pressure tested, at 1.5 times its proposed maximum operating pressure. Also, as part of our ongoing operations and maintenance of the pipeline, for the life of the pipeline, it'll be leak surveyed at least annually, and it will be patrolled at least quarterly. The patrolling process would assure that there's no activity taking place within the alignment of the pipeline. So, based on our procedures, federal and state requirements, we are highly confident that there would be no issues with regard to safety, as was mentioned earlier.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ed. Another issue that came up that I just want to respond to briefly, the issue of noise. What we're saying is that it's the incremental effect of this project that is what we're talking about as being indiscernible to the human ear. We understand that people can hear Route 6 now. What we're saying is that, for example, if we were at Mr. Hanlon's house and we were on his porch or the second floor window was open, whatever noise we hear, whatever noise his family hears now, is going to be exactly the same as if once the project is in place. That's what that 0.2 dBA calculation supports. And that calculation, when we say it's a conservative calculation, that's because it's based on a number of conservative assumptions based on recognized science and recognized noise measurement standards. So.
Thank you.
So there'll be no noise mitigation?
Sure. So the point there is that the visual mitigation that we're putting in is the focus. And you will get some noise benefits from the visual mitigation that we're putting in. What we're saying is that there's no noise impacts to mitigate because of the 0.2 at most dBA increase.
Thank you.
So once again, there'll be no...
No dialogue, please.
I think he said it. There is no noise mitigation. Thank you.
Can he address what is the visual mitigation that he's actually speaking?
I'm sorry. The public portion has been taken care of. Everyone had their say. Thank you. Any staff comments?
Yes, thank you. Just a few. By way of clarification, there was reference to a Cape Cod Commission document earlier in the discussion. It was actually to a 2006 decision, which has no relevance or bearing on this project or this review. So just so you're aware of that. To inform the commission and the public, the written materials which have been received today will be entered into the revised project record, so be assured of that. Finally, the written decision that's before the commission today includes the applicant's proposed condition, which has been reviewed and found acceptable to commission staff. Thank you.
Thank you. At this time, I will entertain a motion to... Oh, I'm sorry. Anyone on the commission have questions?
Mr. Chairman, for the benefit of the public, could staff please read that highlighted part in the report that was written? We all have it in front of us. Just let them hear it from our staff. Or your words are great. You can do it yourself if you choose, Mr. Chairman. Or counselor.
Page 15. John, thank you.
Okay. Mr. Knight, are you referring to the GC new condition?
GC 15,
absolutely. Condition reads as such. The applicant shall implement the visual mitigation program as described in its pre-filed written testimony. is filed on January 15, 2013, and as further described by the applicant at the public hearings on January 23, 2013, and February 14, 2013. Consistent with the visual mitigation program, the applicant shall work with each affected homeowner located within 300 feet of the project layout in good faith to provide reasonable vegetative screening. Upon completion of the visual mitigation program and 30 days prior to issuance of a final certificate of compliance, the applicant shall submit for commission staff review a final report that will include the following information. 1. The names and addresses of each homeowner contacted by the company. 2. The names and addresses of each homeowner who requested vegetative screening. 3. The vegetative screening discussed with each homeowner. 4. The vegetative screening implemented. And 5. An identification of any disagreement between a homeowner and the company with respect to the vegetative screening. To the extent there is a dispute between the company and a homeowner, commission staff will determine whether additional vegetative screening as described in the visual mitigation program should be made available to such homeowner. If the commission staff determines that additional vegetative screening is appropriate, the company shall be required to implement said additional vegetative screening as proposed by the commission staff. Satisfaction of this condition shall be a prerequisite to receipt of a final certificate of compliance by the company.
Thank you, John. Any other questions?
Not questions. Statement, Mr. Chairman. I think upon the last meeting, this is a significant, for me, it's a significant part of this process where it's now in writing. And I think I'm happy to see that. That's what I'll just say on that part.
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm going to echo that same sentiment that my esteemed counselor from the opposite side of the Cape has echoed, that we didn't have this before, and I think that it's a credit to the applicant that they really heard a lot of the concerns that were voiced at the testimony was given at the last hearing, the hearing before. We didn't have this before, and this is a direct response to that input and the concern that was shared by commission members on our side of the table as well. So I appreciate the fact that the applicants come forward with a requirement, a condition in writing, and there's an enforcement measure that lies with the commission should there be a dispute that we can arbitrate on that, and we can work to come up with some sort of resolution that's acceptable. So I want to thank the applicant for coming up with that, and I hope that does something to allay not all, but some of the concerns that people have voiced from the affected community. So I think the movement has been made in that direction. Is it perfect? Probably not. But is it a step in good faith in the right direction? I think it is.
Thank you. Yes, Len.
I was the one who really made a rather big issue out of the having an arbitrator involved in disputes. And I agree with my colleagues here that the company has heard what was said and has attempted, I think in good faith, to correct that problem that concerned me a great deal the last time around.
Thank you. Roy?
Through you, Mr. Chairman, if the company could answer the question of why is this project important?
Do you want someone from the company to respond to that?
It was mentioned in the DRI application filing as well as previous testimony. The driver of the project is to increase the capacity to the gas, natural gas distribution system on the Cape to allow assured service to our existing gas customers, as well as providing capacity to allow for future growth. Other folks that may want to convert to natural gas, they'll have that opportunity. This project allows for that. In addition, as we had mentioned earlier, presently we rely on liquid natural gas as well as a supplement to the pipeline during peak demand periods, which is typically through the winter. This project will also reduce our reliance on that LNG. And so, in total, it's providing more reliability to the greater Cape natural gas distribution system.
Thank you.
Julie?
General condition number 15 refers to the visual mitigation program. It doesn't explain it fully, but there is a lot of paperwork on that, and I would like the applicant to just talk about the logistics and the program basics and the variations of your mitigation program. I think it's impressive. I think they're trying to do the best for everybody, but I think that that would be interesting to the public who has not heard what the visual mitigation program is to hear it today. And then my second question are, why do you have Robert O'Neill in our packet? What is he going to be doing for you, since he seems to be an expert on sound?
My name again is Ted Barton with Epsilon Associates. I'm an environmental engineer by training, and I and my company have provided most of the environmental analyses that have gone into not only the materials that are before the Cape Cod Commission, but also the work that we provided to the Siting Board and to MEPA. So let me start with the second of your questions, because that was probably the more, it's the easier to answer. Rob O'Neill is a sound expert. He's one of my partners at Epsilon. He is the person that I rely on when we have noise issues to measure, to analyze, to discuss, to talk about. So the information that we provided on noise going back a couple of submittals ago was something that I worked up in consultation with Rob, and his resume was included just to give folks on the commission a sense for the depth of expertise that was brought to bear on the noise issue. Rob has worked in the noise field for some 20 years all across the country. He's provided expert testimony at trial, at hearings. He's a member of the Institute of Noise Control Engineers, somebody who is truly an expert in that subject. We didn't bring him today because we thought we had pretty well covered the material, but we just wanted to have a feel for the depth that went into that.
And what will he be doing as the project moves on, as COVID-19?
Well, going back to Mike Kaler's comment, our contention is that the whatever noise levels are being experienced by residents along Service Road now are going to be essentially the same once the project is built. So based on our confidence in that, we frankly don't expect Rob to be doing anything going forward. However, if there was a noise issue of some sort that was to arise, be it in construction or beyond, Rob is a resource that National Grid can call on to look into that. So, let me talk a little bit about the visual mitigation program. And this is, it is something that we put a lot of thought into, and I appreciate the opportunity to go back over that. And let me just start with a few of the basic parameters. Right now, there is about 120 feet of vegetation between the north side of Service Road and the nearest travel lane of Route 6. About 40 feet of that is between Service Road and the fence. The balance of it is between the fence and Route 6. It's obviously on state property. The fence is the demarcation of the town right away that Mr. Tilton talked about. So we're talking about clearing a 10 to 15 foot strip of the vegetation closest to Service Road. which will leave about 20 feet of vegetation between Service Road and the fence, and another roughly 70 or 80 feet beyond the fence, between the fence and Route 6. In addition to that, there is vegetation on the south side of Service Road, the side where the homes are. And that does, as several speakers have mentioned, it varies. And it varies from, in some cases, relatively little. Folks have fences with some vegetation along it. In other cases, there can be as much as 100 or 200 feet of vegetation between Service Road and people's homes. And I'm talking about basically the first row of homes along Service Road. We are not going to do anything to that vegetation. Whatever is there on town property or on people's individual properties, that remains untouched by the project. So the visual mitigation program that we put together is intended to deal with the effects of removing that 10 to 15 feet of trees, recognizing that there will be very substantial amounts of vegetation left in place. And as we've described, this is going to be kind of a case-by-case exercise because there are variations in the amount of vegetation along the road on the south side. There are variations in terrain between the homes and Route 6. There are variations in how far the homes are set back from the road. So our intention is once the construction is done, and this would be done by phase. So phase one of the project, assuming it's built this year, the visual mitigation program would be implemented for that first roughly 2 miles in the late summer or fall of this year. And for the second phase, it would be next year in 2014. So as we approach the end of construction, a letter would be sent to each homeowner within 300 feet. As was suggested at the last hearing, folks thought it was appropriate that a phone call follow-up be made, and we'd be happy to do that to make sure that everybody, in fact, has gotten the letter. And the letter will introduce the project, it'll introduce the visual mitigation program, and it will say to folks, are you interested in talking with a National Grid representative to discuss what measures might be done on your property? And our assumption is that many folks will want to talk about that. They will follow up. The National Grid person responsible for this will make an appointment. Go out to the person's house. The idea is to be able to essentially stand in the front yard or on the back deck to really get a feel for what differences, if any, there are based on the clearing of this narrow strip that has been done. And then with that in mind, talk about what kinds of plantings could be done to best mitigate or buffer that. And in some cases, there might be a very complete screen of existing trees, and there might not be a need to do anything. In other cases, people may have homes that are relatively open to the service road, and in that case, you may do a fairly complete planting along the front of the property. And we talked about in our document the kinds of trees that would be used. These would be typically 6 to 8 foot tall, a decent diameter, planted by a landscape professional, so a proper hole dug for the root ball, soil amendment or soils brought in to supplement what's there if necessary. The plants will be mulched, watered in, etc. And we are going to ask that the homeowner be responsible for watering the plants once they're put in initially. However, if anything doesn't survive the first growing season, they'll be replaced. All of this obviously be done at no cost to the homeowner. We've also outlined some situations where the right place to put the plantings may not be on the homeowner's property. It may be closer to Service Road, which would be on town property, in which case the town would have to be amenable to the plantings that are recommended. And there might be a few instances where the right place to put the plantings are on the south side of Service Road. So in those cases, we would consult with the town. We'd have to be mindful of things like sight lines along Service Road, sight lines from driveways, existing utilities, et cetera, et cetera. But the point of this is that we'll do these case by case. As we said the last time, our intention is not to quibble with homeowners. Our intention is to try to do this right. And significantly, if we don't get it right, there's now an umpire, the Cape Cod Commission staff, who can make the final call. So in somewhat short form, that's what we have in mind.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Joy?
I'm
thank you. Andrew?
I'm sorry. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Two things, one of which, of course, I touched on last time. We talk about visual mitigation, and at the last commission meeting, I'd spoken up about the concern with the traffic on Route 6, noticing there's another road. We had talked about issues with traffic that could affect the residents nearby. As I said last time, when visitors of Cape Cod who are frequent visitors notice that there's all of a sudden another way around the traffic they're sitting in, they take it. And now that road becomes clogged. And of course, these residents are used to a certain way of living, and of course, that does not include the road being clogged up with a lot of tourists. I just want to be perfectly clear that I heard the correct answer today, which is that there will be no replanting of trees where trees will be taken down, regardless of whether that area along Route 6 has a lot of trees, or of course, if we're talking about an area along this route where there is very little in terms of vegetation, where taking down 10 to 15 feet of trees would, of course, make it almost completely bare next to Route 6. So I just want to make sure I'm clear that there will be no replanting of trees on the area or around the area in which the pipeline is going in. The mitigation we're talking about is strictly with the properties of the homeowners. So am I correct in that?
That part is correct, but the supposition that there are places where, I think as you just put it, Service Road is almost bare or easily visible from Route 6, I would submit that that is not correct, other than perhaps in a few limited instances where you're talking about an interchange. And there are,
let me finish.
We have driven Service Road dozens of times. We've run out detailed aerial
photos.
Ladies
and gentlemen, please. I'm sorry for the interruption.
Thank you. We've run out detailed aerial photos, and for the entire 4 mile stretch that we're talking about, there is a minimum of 80 or 90 feet of vegetation that will remain after the project is done. Now, we have stated repeatedly that we're going to take out 10 to 15 feet of trees, but that is about 10% of what is there now. Now, when you drive on Route 6 now in the defoliate season, you can certainly see Service Road readily. In the summer, when the leaves are out, my guess is that in most places you cannot see it, and you won't be able to see it when this narrow strip of trees is removed as well. So, you know, will somebody spot Service Road and bail off Route 6 and drive on it? You know, we don't know the answer to that. The roads have been there for 50 years. They're readily seen on any map, on any GPS system. So if somebody's really anxious to find a detour, I think they can find it with or without whatever we're going to do out there.
Thank you. Roger. I had a mechanical question. The number of people who received notices, of the people who should have received notices, are we sure we had a correct list?
I can respond to that. Jessica Wilgus, Commission Counsel.
In terms of the abutters list, the Cape Cod Commission Act requires that that list be certified by the tax assessor of the town. So when we received the list, it had been certified by the town, and we then used that certified list to notify those members or those abutters who have been identified that are within the area that the act requires. So yes, we know that.
Thank you.
You talked about the LNG would, the supplemental LNG would be diminished, the amount brought to the Cape. How is that brought to the Cape now?
Presently, we have three LNG locations on the Cape. One is in South Yarmouth, one is in Chatham, one is in Eastham. South Yarmouth is a permanent facility. Chatham and Eastham are satellite, if you will, temporary or portable locations. All three locations, however, receive LNG via truck. And the South Yarmouth location has a field-directed tank for storage, and that tank is filled by trucks. And so for National Grid to be able to reduce the volume of trucking, logistically, obviously, that helps the cause as well.
Any idea how many trips would be eliminated by this project?
I think we did go through that exercise offhand. I can't say.
Okay. And one final question. What's the working pressure on the main?
The main presently operates at 270 pounds. It will be operating at that pressure for the foreseeable future. However, we're designing it to operate at 575 pounds.
Thank you.
Aye.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Wentz, you might not want to take your seat just yet. I want to ask you a question that last hearing, most of the concerns seemed to revolve around the visual mitigation, probably some of the sound mitigation concerns. What's been brought up in this hearing a few times is the concern for safety. And I wondered if you could, you've talked specifically about the makeup of the pipeline, the materials involved, the process, the inspectors' qualifications. Can you speak a little bit to, just briefly, to the history of how the company has handled any kinds of gas leaks or any kinds of significant concerns or debacles with gas?
Well, we, as I touched on briefly, we have a typical maintenance program, an operating program where we will survey all of our facilities at a given frequency every year. So that's one thing. So as a proactive approach, we're monitoring all of the pipelines. There were a leak to be identified, there are a number of methods of determining that, one through the survey process. Another would be a call from the general public. As you're probably all aware, there's an odorant put in the gas. And the reason for that is if there is a leak, it'll be detected. The gas company will be notified, will respond, and address it. And so all of our local operations, the Cape is no different. We have a staff of trained personnel that respond appropriately to any either call for leaks, going out and identifying if a leak exists, and then repairing it and addressing it.
Thank you. Any other questions, comments from commission members? If not, I will entertain a motion. A motion to close the hearing and the record. Any further comments on the motion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any against, say nay. Any abstentions? Passes unanimously. Thank you. Now, would anyone care to make a second motion? If I would entertain a motion to move to approve the Sagamore Line Reinforcement Project as a DRI and to approve the draft written decision as amended.
So moved, Mr. Chairman. Second.
Any further discussion on that motion?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just want to say that through the process of these hearings and the testimony given, it's been enheartening to see testimony come forward from the public. What I think is most enheartening is to see that steps were taken and a lot of those concerns were addressed. And as I said earlier, I understand they're not perfectly addressed, and some people probably came forward with the idea that it would be best if the project were just not allowed whatsoever. There are benefits and detriments that we're charged with weighing up and down with regard to each project that comes forward. And I look at this, and I look at the substantial GC-15 that was added as a result of the testimony was given last week, or 2 weeks ago, rather. And I think some good faith movement has been made to try to answer some of the concerns of the general public. Without that, I, for one, probably would have seen, I would have had a concern with regard to the element of good faith that the company is expressing with regard to this project. But seeing the addition that's been worked on out between commission staff and the applicant with regard to the conditioning of this agreement, I feel much more encouraged to support this, so I will be voting in favor.
Any other comments on the motion? I'd just like to assure the people here that our jurisdiction is limited. There are some things we can rule on and others that we can only suggest. And I think we've gone about as far as we can on this motion.
Our jurisdiction is limited, but if we vote yes on this project, our jurisdiction is strong. And it means that we are overseeing this project and we know your concerns. I think we've had a good working relationship with NSTAR. They've listened to your concerns 2 weeks ago. They've listened to the commissioner's concerns and incorporated solutions to our questions. But by having the Cape Cod Commission in charge of this project, we will be there as a mediator if there's a problem. We will be there if there's noise. We will be there if there's visual impact. That's what our staff does and would do on this project and on any other project that comes before us.
Any further comments, questions on the motion?
No, sir.
Calling the question, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, please say nay. Any abstentions? Motion?
I'm sorry?
One abstention. Motion passes. Thank you. Moving on to our agenda.
Yes, Mr. Chair. The two remaining items, the delegations of authority and the Mullen rule, I'd like to withdraw them from this agenda.
Watch that video. Those two agenda items have been postponed. Is there any other business before the commission? Seeing none, any member comments at this time? Seeing none, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. Thank you.